Hello and welcome in this session of your course BES 141 Pedagogy of Science. I am Dr. Gaurav Singh, your course instructor, and today I am going to deal with a very important topic under the theme food called nutrient management and cropping pattern. We are not going to discuss much about the content of the nutrient management and cropping pattern. Rather, we will focus on how you will deal with these concepts in your class, what kind of methodology you will adopt, what kind of assessment pattern you will adopt, how you can facilitate the teaching learning of your learners in these concepts. So actually, when we start about the nutrient management, from where these nutrients are coming from the food items which are being produced through different agricultural practices. So when we talk about the agricultural practices, we came across the concept like crop. So what is a crop? When plants of same kind are cultivated at one place on a large scale, it is called a crop. But if you see the agricultural practices in India, you will find regional practices are different. For example, if you see the area like Punjab, Haryana, Madhya Pradesh, they produce more wheat. If you go to the eastern part of our country, they produce more rice. If you go to the southern part, they produce coconut. If you go to the western Ghats region, they produce nuts and many other things. So when we think about the agricultural practices or the cropping pattern across the country, it is different. And why it is different? Because the production of crop is depend upon the climate and soil of that particular area. For example, for rice, you require a lot of water. So you cannot produce rice generally in the area which are with low rainfall. You require a particular kind of soil to produce wheat. You require a particular type of soil to produce pulses. So when you deal with the agricultural practices of the country in your class, you along with that also deal that what impact the climate and soil has on crop production. Then when you talk about the crop production, you basically explain them the basic practices of crop production, like how a farmer prepares soil, how they sow the seeds, how they add manure and fertilizers, what are the irrigation patterns and facilities available at a particular area, how they protect their crops from weeds, how they harvest the crop, and how they store it. So this is the basic process of crop production which you will find across the country, though cropping patterns are different. So how you can explain this concept? Do you think you will tell in the class, okay, today I'm going to talk about the basic practices of crop production? Write down the step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5. No. You are not going to push your learners by giving certain concepts in their mind. You ask your learners that let them discuss the farmer in their area, that how they grow crops in their fields. You can give them a small project. Okay, today you go at your home, in a day or two or in a week, you meet anyone who is doing farming and you discuss what kind of crops they are producing and what are the steps which they follow while producing the crop. Let every learner make it a list, come to the class, you arrange them into small groups, that each group let discuss what they found and they should come out on the consensus. Then they should present it in front of the class that according to our group, these are the basic steps. According to our group, these are the basic steps. And then they will themselves realize and bring out the common steps of crop production. So there will be no need of pushing towards the content, rather content and concept will emerge from their discussion, from their experiences. And what is your role? Your role is just to provide them right kind of activity, right kind of support, and right kind of design where they can collect the information, they can discuss about it, and they can share with their peers. So how you can deal with these topics? One possibility is stories. You can share the stories of the farmers. If there is a parent in your class who is doing farming, you can invite him or her to your class and let he or she tell to the students how farming is being done. If you have the facility at your school, you can use the video animation. There are many small video pictures and animation videos are there. You can show them to your students. Or you can even organize the role play activity also. Okay, you are a farmer. You need to grow certain crop in your field. What will you do? What will you do? Let them explore, let them design, let them play. And the whole class will enjoy. So you make even the very straight topics also very enjoyable by using variety of techniques and tools when you deal with such topics. Now, how will you assess it? Because assessment is also an important part of it. So how will you assess it? You can ask your students to collect the pictures of the equipments required at each step. What are the equipments which are required for preparing the soil? What are the equipments which are required for removing the weeds? What are the equipments which are required for irrigation? What are the equipments which are required for fertilization? Let them collect all those pictures. So, let them arrange those pictures into a particular sequence. Into a particular sequence according to the steps identified by them. So if they are able to do so, it means they have understood the concept. So you will assess them. You can give them picture puzzles also. You can put the different steps of the farming in a puzzle and you can ask what is going on in this picture. You can give them card sequencing activity, like you can prepare a different cards of different activities of the whole crop production process and let them jumble all those cards. Give to your students, let them arrange the cards into a sequence. That can be one activity. You can give a project of germinating the seeds at home and let them write that what steps they have followed when they germinated the seeds of wheat or rice or maize or anything at their home they can do. So there are variety of activities through which you can assess. So don't think that assessment is only possible through paper pencil test. You need to think. I have already told you that whenever you are going to deal with any particular concept in your science class, you think first the concepts involved in it. You think about the processes and the designs which you can follow to facilitate your learners or to expose your learners towards these concepts. How they can explore more, how can you explain it, and how can you assess it. So keep all these engage, assess, explore, expand everything in your mind whenever you are planning any teaching learning for your class. So when you talk about the cropping pattern, the process of crop production, you may come across a topic called fertilizers. So what are the fertilizers? You all know that fertilizers are the chemicals which are rich in particular nutrients, like urea is a fertilizer, ammonium sulfate is a fertilizer, superphosphate is a fertilizer, potash is there, NPK is a common name, nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. So you can give some challenging questions like what farmers were using when there were no fertilizers, because we are producing crops since very long. Fertilizers have very recent production. It can be not more than 100 years. But earlier there were no fertilizers and we are producing crops from 1000 years. What we were using, what is a manure, how it is different from fertilizers. These can be some instigative questions to help your learners to understand that what all these concepts are. So how can you introduce the concept of fertilizer to your students? You can ask your learners to discuss the benefits of the fertilizers as well as what are the harms of the fertilizers, because now it is being said that if soils are over fertilized, a lot of fertilizers we are giving from the external sources, soil slowly become dead or become less fertile. Then if there is excess fertilizers in the field, it causes water pollution because they flow with the rainwater and they mix with the river and they pollute the water. And also if plants or the paddy is consuming excess fertilizer, its parts remain in the seeds. So when it comes to us, it is harmful for our health. So many, many things are there. So when you deal with the fertilizer, you deal what is a fertilizer, you discuss what are the benefits of the fertilizer, you discuss what are the harms of the fertilizer, how can you do it? How can you deal with this topic? You can organize debate, you can organize discussion, you can give group projects, many things you can do. And slowly you can move from fertilizer to manure. So what is a manure? We all know fertilizer is a man-made inorganic salt, like urea, like NPK, all that. But manure is the natural substance which is obtained by the decomposition of cattle dung or plant residue. So where do we prepare fertilizers? We prepare fertilizers in the factories, but where we can prepare manure at our field, at our home? Fertilizer never provide any humus or the upper fertile layer to the soil, but manure always provides a upper fertile layer to the soil. Fertilizers are very rich in the plant nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, because they are specifically designed. But manures are relatively less rich in the plant nutrients. So you talk about what are fertilizers, what are manures, what are the difference between fertilizers and manures. So what you can do? You can ask your students to find out the benefits of the manure or the shortcomings of the fertilizers. If there is any vermicompost center or a place where vermicompost is being done, what is vermicompost? You all know. Your students must have studied in their previous classes that they use worms like earthworm to decompose the leaves and the cow dung and other things to a compost. So how this vermicompost works, you can arrange a visit of your students there if it is in your nearby area. Then there are many new concepts emerging like hybridized crops, GM crops, organic farming. These are the new concepts which are emerging. Though these terms are very common because many students must have learned about or heard about these terms in the newspaper or in the news discussions or somewhere else, or even when they are visiting to any store, they found, okay, this, if pulses are there in a packet, then some are organic pulses, some are organic wheat. So what do you mean by organic? Why it is different from others? Why it is more costly than others? There can be many questions, many combinations of the questions which a student can deal with. So with these new concepts exploration, you can expand the horizon of their knowledge. Then we can talk about irrigation. We all know irrigation is required for production of crops. And as you can see in the picture, there are multiple ways of irrigation. There can be rahat, a traditional Indian old model, then can be a tube well, then it can be from the canals, then it can be from the sprinkling, it can be from well. Multiple sources are there. So when you are dealing with the irrigation type of topics, what is irrigation? Irrigation is basically the supply of the water to crops at regular interval. It is called irrigation because crops require water. What are the sources of irrigations? If you ask your students, they will tell you the wells, the tube wells, the ponds, the lakes, the rivers, and dams and canals and everything. They can tell you all these resources because if you are dealing with this concept at a higher level, means at the 9th or in the class 7th or 8th or 9th, you generally deal with these topics. So then they have a basic idea at their primary level about all these concepts. So they can tell you these sources. Now you can ask them that what were the traditional systems of irrigation? So they may find in the textbooks also, they may find in their home also, or they can find at the internet also, that what are the various sources or what are the various systems of irrigation earlier. So there was a pulley system called moat, there was a chain pump, then in some places there was dhekli, then there was a system called rahat. How you will introduce these systems to your learner? One is the discussion with the farmer, a traditional farmer, an old person who is well versed about the older system of irrigation. Maybe the new generation farmer are not aware about these irrigation systems, but the old generation farmers have used it. So you can arrange a talk. There are multiple video files available, like how Rahat work, how Dekli work. So you can download those videos and you can, you know, play it in your class, and you can organize the discussion. Or you can organize a debate between the traditional system of irrigation and the modern system of irrigation. Let half class think about the traditional system of irrigation. Let half class think about the modern system of irrigation and let them compare. So when we talk about the modern system of irrigation, we basically talk about the sprinkle system and the drip system. If possible, you can organize a visit of a field where a sprinkling or drip system is being used. If not, then you can show them pictures, you can show them videos, how a sprinkle system or drip system is better than the traditional systems, how we can save water by using these methods, how it is more efficient method, what kind of crops should be there to use this method. All these things you can study. So you can organize a talk on traditional methods, you can debate on traditional and modern methods. And now there are many projects or many government initiatives are there, like one per drop, more crop and other schemes. So you can give a project to your students to explore more about these initiatives and how these are affecting the production of the crops. Whenever you deal with any topic, you need to think how you will give more and more opportunity to your learners. Then comes another very important topic called cropping patterns. There are many ways of growing crops in India, and now cropping patterns are being used. There are basically two patterns which are now promoting nowadays. One is called mixed cropping and another is called intercropping. Mixed cropping means growing two or more crops simultaneously on the same piece of land, like wheat and gram, wheat and mustard, groundnut and sunflower. So both things are being sowed at the same time, at the same piece of land. Then there is intercropping, means growing two or more crops simultaneously on the same field in a rotation basis. So that is called intercropping. So both things can be used. So growing of the different crops on a piece of land in a pre-planned succession is called crop rotation. So you can ask any farmer of your nearby area to explain the rotation is being followed by him or her. For example, if you see the North India, especially the Uttar Pradesh and other states, what farmers are doing, they have a pattern like one cycle of wheat and rice, then they replace in another cycle with mustard and pulses, or mustard and sugarcane. Then after sugarcane and mustard, they again come to the wheat and rice. So they follow a particular pattern to keep their field healthy. Because if field is healthy, it will give good production despite of using the fertilizers. So what you can do, you can give them many activities, like you can give some small projects on crop patterns in different regions in India. Let them explore what kind of crop patterns in northern part of India, what are the crop patterns in southern part of the India, what are the crop patterns in eastern or western part of the India. You can give them mapping exercise also, where they identify that which is the major crop of which particular state. So let them mark it on a map. So that can be one activity. You can ask them to collect information about a specific climate need for various crops, that for what kind of crop, what kind of climate is required. That can be one activity. Then you can talk about types of crops in India. When we think about basically the crops in India, we can classify the types of crops in India on certain basis. First is the basis of climate. So on the basis of climate, we say either tropical crops are there or temperate crops are there. Like rice, sugarcane, jowar, which requires more water, are tropical type of crops. And temperate crops are wheat, oats, potato, which require comparatively less water. So if you are explaining this concept, like tropical and temperate crops, how will you introduce it? It means first you need to introduce them the geography, the geographical concept of tropical zone and temperate zone. let them identify the area on the map on the basis of average temperature of a particular area, that which state falls on a tropical zone and which states fall on temperate zone. Then let them identify what are the major crops of those areas, and they can do it. So you can add the map activity and the idea of geographical concepts for explaining this. Then there can be, which is the most common classification in India actually, which is based on the season. In which season the crop is being grown? They are Kharif, Rabi and Zayad. Kharif is basically monsoon crops like cotton, rice, jowar, maize. Again, the crops which require more water. Rabi is winter crops like wheat, gram, sunflower, groundnut. And in between Rabi and Kharif, there are some summer crops also. When the field is, you know, vacant for 1 month or 2 month duration between Rabi and Kharif, then few farmers use these Zayad crops like watermelon, pumpkin, because these are seasonal crops. It takes only 1 to 2 months to grow, and it do not require to engage the whole field for 5-6 months. Generally, Kharif or Rabi, they require 5 to 6 months or 4 to 6 months. It depends upon the temperature and the paddy which you are basically growing. Then there can be a classification on the basis of duration of the crop. Like the seasonal crops are there, rice, wheat, jowar. Then seasonal crops, then there could be two seasonal crops like cotton, ginger. Then there can be annual crops, means only once you can produce those, like sugarcane, because it requires 9 to 10 months. Then biennial crops are there. Biennial crops means in 1 year the product will come, in 1 year it may not come. So banana, papaya are there. Then perennials are mango, guava. So many, 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 many types of crops are there. Similarly, on the basis of the economic importance, we call some crops as cash crops and some crops as food crops. So rice, wheat, maize, pulses, these are food crops. Cotton, sugarcane, tobacco, oil seeds, all these are cash crops. So when you are trying to deal with all these concepts, whether the types of crop, cropping pattern, different types of cropping pattern in different parts of the country, irrigation, multiple themes are there which you need to deal under the category food in some classes. So under this theme food, when we deal with the concepts like crop, cropping pattern, nutrition management, fertilizers and all, we need to deal with some examples. We need to find some examples from their daily life. We need to connect it with their life experiences. We need to engage the people who are actually doing these work. For example, in this case, you can see that farmers are the best resource. So if you give an opportunity to your learners to interact with the farmers, they will learn better as compared to your classroom teaching learning. So my suggestion will be that when we deal with all such topics or all such concepts, we think what are the resources available at our end, how we can use these resources best for the benefit of our learner, and how we can introduce, how we can facilitate, and how we can assess the performance of the learners or the progress of the learners on a particular theme or a particular topic. So I hope that is, if you will deal with these topics the ways which I have suggested to you, maybe you may having more better ways than me, so you can use those also. But always utilize different ways. You give different kinds of experiences to your learners and they will learn better. So be an active and authentic teacher, and let learning be active and authentic. Thank you very much.